Committee will come to order. I'd like to begin this hearing by stating the Oversight and Government Reform Mission Statement. We exist to secure two fundamental principles. First, Americans have a right to know that the money Washington takes from them is well spent. And second, Americans deserve an efficient, effective government that works for them. Our duty on the Oversight and Government Reform Committee is to protect these rights. Our solemn responsibility is to hold the government accountable to taxpayers because taxpayers have a right to know what they get from their government. We will work tirelessly in partnership with citizen watchdogs to deliver the facts to the American people and bring genuine reform to the Federal bureaucracy. This is the mission of the Oversight and Government Reform Committee. I appreciate everybody here. I appreciate your patience here as we had votes on the floor, and we will have votes in approximately an hour and 15 minutes or so. I want to welcome everybody to this hearing, which is entitled SIGAR Report, Document Destruction of Millions of Dollars Unaccounted for at the Department of Defense, Part 2. I'd like to welcome members from both sides, in particular Mr. Lynch, who's worked tirelessly on these types of issues. Today's proceedings continue the Subcommittee's efforts to oversee billions of dollars of taxpayer dollars spent in support of military and civilian operations within Afghanistan. Last week, the Special Inspector General for Afghanistan Reconstruction, or the SIGAR, Mr. John Sopko, testified before this committee on the findings contained in an interim report entitled, quote, Interim Report on Afghanistan National Army Petroleum Oil and Lubricants, otherwise known as POL. His report contains serious allegations of potential waste, fraud, and abuse and document destruction associated with POL procurement. I want to thank Mr. Sopko for being here again today and for the work that he and his team do. Given this finding, we found it necessary to seek answers from the Department of Defense. We also believe it is necessary to talk about the broader issue of direct assistance to foreign governments, including Afghanistan. USAID has considerable experience in this area, and I look forward to hearing how they ensure accountability in other regions. From fiscal years 2007 to 2012, SISTICA has channeled approximately $1.1 billion through the Afghan Security Force Fund to purchase petroleum oil lubricants for the Afghan National Army. In fiscal year 13, the U.S. government will purchase approximately $343 million more in POL. According to Mr. Sopko, SISTICA does not have an accurate or supportable information on three key things: how much U.S. funds are needed for ANA fuel, where and how the fuel is actually used, and how much of the fuel has been lost or sold. Those seem to be some very basic, simple questions that everybody should be able to see and have in order to make reasonable, rational decisions. Thus, to the extent in which ANA fuel is in stock, consumed or lost at any given time remains an unknown. Mr. Sopko also testified that, quote, no single office within the U.S. or Afghan government has a complete records on ANA fuel purchased, ordered, delivered, and consumed, end quote. There are allegations that the Defense Department may have shredded financial records for hundreds of millions of dollars in POL. And yet at this time, there is a seeking to increase this assistance by hundreds of millions of dollars. If accurate, this is totally unacceptable. I have been working closely with Mr. Tierney, and perhaps we will introduce legislation soon to redirect this effort. Despite the lack of records and justification for fuel purchases, the Department of Defense proposes increasing funding. From fiscal year 14 to fiscal year 18, it plans to provide $555 million worth of POL per year. The Department of Defense plans to give two-thirds of this funding directly to the Afghan government starting on January 1, 2013, so that it can buy the petroleum, oil, and lubricants for itself. This from a government which I believe is one of the most corrupt governments on the face of the planet. It begs the question, why do we even bother sending it to Afghanistan? Why don't we just send it to Dubai and let them just put it in their own bank accounts? There are some serious questions. We're here to try to provide more oversight, and yet what I see the direction of the Department of Defense going is less oversight, less accountability. And that's, again, why USAID is here. They, too, seem to be moving in this direction. We can't get the basic information about what we're consuming and what's being used, and the administration keeps moving in a direction to send it directly to them. We can't even account for it. We think the Afghans are going to account for it, and we're going to increase their funding. That's why we're here today. Under the current plan, the Afghan government will be responsible for overseeing the expenditure of roughly $2.8 billion of our taxpayer dollars. There are virtually no assurances, however, that the Afghans will properly oversee this money. We simply cannot delegate the authority and oversight of billions of taxpayer dollars to the Afghan government without reliable controls in place. Trust but verify. I believe that, and we are not doing that in this instance. Afghanistan is not the only recipient of direct assistance, however. This administration has made it a priority to increase direct assistance to governments in developing countries all over the world. Under President Obama, the USAID has developed a new initiative called Forward. Under this program, the administration plans to double the amount of U.S. foreign aid budget it gives directly to foreign governments, NGOs, and businesses. Already, between fiscal year 2009 and 2010, the administration has more than tripled its awards of direct assistance to Afghanistan to $2 billion. And overall, excluding Afghanistan and Pakistan, the administration goal is to give 30% of nearly $40 billion in foreign aid budget directly to foreign governments, NGOs, and businesses by 2015. This is a staggering figure. I would like to hear from USAID how it ensures accountability in other regions and whether lessons can be applied to the Department of Defense. We must also get a better handle of who is receiving the contracts. In a letter on Tuesday, Mr. Sopko listed 43 contractors in Afghanistan with affiliations to the Haqqani Network, the Taliban, or Al-Qaeda. According to this letter, these entities have not been suspended or debarred by the U.S. government. The fact that these firms with known affiliations to terrorist groups are omitted from the debarment list is simply outrageous. I want to know why the Defense Department has not acted on the SIGAR's recommendations in a timely manner. And I hope today's discussions include solutions on how to prevent groups with terrorist ties from doing business with the United States. I want to thank all the witnesses for being here on short notice. I appreciate your patriotism, your commitment to the country. What I like to share with people is what differentiates the United States of America from everybody else is we have these types of candid discussions in the light of day on television so that everybody can see and hear the good, the bad, and ugly, all with the same mutual goal of making it better. That's why we're here today. I'm not here to just try to embarrass people. We're trying to make it better and challenge the notions that are potentially there on the table. So I appreciate these gentlemen who are here answering the questions from the panel. And I'd like to recognize a distinguished ranking member, the gentleman from Massachusetts, who's worked tirelessly. I appreciate the partnership we have in trying to put good government in place, and I'd like to recognize Mr. Tierney for his opening statement.
Well, I thank the Chairman for that. I thank our witnesses for being here today. And again, the SIGAR, thank you, Mr. Sopko, for your report last week and your testimony as well. I'm glad to see you back here again today. Mr. Chairman, other than to just take this opportunity to acknowledge and honor the loss of Ambassador Chris Stevens and the three other United States citizens, and note that we've had our 51st death of NATO forces on the so-called blue-green situation, and we honor the sacrifice of them and their families and all of the people that are dedicated servants still serving, and to note that I think we have a joint interest here in making sure that our investments in development, while laudable, are threatened by the potential that they may exacerbate the situation as opposed to improve it, and that a lot of the oversight work has to be done to make sure that this program or any program like it works to our advantage and not to our disadvantage. I will ask that we just accept my remarks for the record and we can proceed.
Absolutely, without question, and so ordered. Does any other member seek to have, would like to make comment in the opening statement?
Mr. Chairman, not any real statement other than I'm going to apologize to the witnesses. I'm doing another meeting here and just wanted to thank the witnesses for written testimony and for you holding this very important hearing. The issue of transparency and getting to the bottom of these issues is so important. I commend you and the ranking member for moving forward with the hearing, and apologize that I will be running out here shortly.
Understood. The flexibility, lots happening today and the lateness in which we start, so I appreciate it. Would the gentleman from Massachusetts care to say anything?
I would. Just a brief statement. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for holding this hearing. I thank the ranking member as well. I know you both worked on these issues extensively. I also want to thank the witnesses for coming before us and trying to help us with our work. This is an important issue for us going forward. The Special Inspector General has been terrific on this issue. Mr. Sopko, you nice enough to join us last week, where we in this committee had the opportunity to hear testimony from the Inspector General for Afghanistan Reconstruction regarding the current system for procuring petroleum, oil, and lubricants for the Afghan security forces. We discovered at that hearing that the process is completely dysfunctional and that the Combined Security Transition Command, Afghanistan, is not yet in a position to ensure that any entity, Afghan National Army or otherwise, will be able to take over future procurement. This is particularly disturbing as the Afghan National Army is set to take control of the petroleum procurement in January 2013. Corruption and lack of transparency are endemic in Afghanistan. I've often said that corruption is to Afghanistan like wet is to water. And that corruption has proven to be a significant hurdle for U.S., allied, and Afghans to overcome as we transition out of Afghanistan. We should not be handing over such responsibilities and resources without being certain that the institutions in question are ready to ensure proper oversight and transparency. That is the mission of this subcommittee as well as the full committee and our responsibility to the American people. The witnesses we have brought here today will be able to shed additional light on the petroleum procurement matter and what is being done to remedy the deficiencies. They will also be able to share what improvements are being done to increase overall oversight of funds provided by the United States taxpayer. Now, look, if we don't have the oversight in place, this money will be stolen. This is billions of dollars of taxpayer money. We all know the situation in Afghanistan, and right now they are totally incapable. We have seen it. We have seen it from Kabul Bank right on down. We have seen it through the fuel supply contracts, terrible corruption. And if we proceed down this road where we just hand billions of dollars over, 30% or otherwise, to the Afghan government without the proper controls there, this money is going to go out the door. This will be stolen. So there is, it makes no sense. It makes no sense to take American taxpayer money and hand it over to people who are not going to spend it for its intended purpose. And I would like to hear from our witnesses today as to how they envision a way forward to ensure that the transition of Afghan control will be sustainable, if not successful. I would like to thank our witnesses for taking the time to come and testify before the subcommittee. Mr. Chairman, thank you for staying on this issue, especially with the short deadline we have in January. We will not be in session that much more before this transition to Afghan control commences. So we have got little time and a lot of work to do. And I just hate to see us, you know, put good money at risk here in any circumstances, but especially right now with the economy and the finances of the United States being what they are. I yield back.
I thank the gentleman. Members may have 7 days to submit opening statements for the record and will now recognize our panel. Mr. John Sopko is the Special Inspector General for Afghan Reconstruction, also known as the SIGAR. The Honorable Alan Estevez is the Assistant Secretary for Logistics and Material Readiness at the Department of Defense. Lieutenant General Brooks Bash is the Director for Logistics with the Joint Staff at the Department of Defense. And Mr. Larry Sampler is the Principal Deputy Assistant to the Administrator and Deputy Director of the Office of Afghan and Pakistan Affairs at the U.S. Agency for International Development. That is quite the title. It's a long one. It just rolls off the tongue. Nevertheless, we're glad that you're all here. It is the pursuant to committee rules, all witnesses need to be sworn in before they testify. If you please rise and raise your right hands. Do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you are about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Thank you. You may be seated. Let the record reflect that all witnesses answered in the affirmative. In order to allow time for discussion, we would appreciate if you would limit your testimony to 5 minutes, but we will be fairly generous with that if you want to continue with the thought. And we will now recognize Mr. Sopko for 5 minutes.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Tierney, and members of the subcommittee. Last week I testified before this subcommittee that SIGAR had serious concerns about how SISTICA has managed and accounted for the fuel provided to the Afghan Army. Despite these problems, SISTICA still plans to increase annual funding for the Afghan Army fuel by $212 million per year and is pushing forward with the transfer of fuel responsibilities and funding to the Afghan Army. We believe there is no basis for either decision, and I continue to urge SISTICA to halt its plan to increase fuel funding until it develops a better process for determining fuel needs, establish a comprehensive action plan to improve fuel accountability, and delay transferring fuel responsibilities and funding to the Afghan Army until the problems we have identified are fixed. Now let me briefly update you on the destruction of records issue. First of all, SIGAR's investigation have identified and begun interviewing individuals located in the United States, Afghanistan, United Kingdom, and Belgium who were involved in this matter. We have confirmed that shredding did indeed take place and have identified two Air Force officers who admitted to destroying documents covering the time periods of February 2010 to February 2011. According to these officers, they obtained supervisory approval to shred the documents because they did not have adequate storage space. They also claimed that they saved them in an electronic format. Our investigators are now working to locate those electronic records to review to see if they are actually the records in question. These are the records, of course, that we requested from in February of this year. In addition, just this Tuesday, CSTICA provided our auditors in Kabul with a CD which they claim contains 97% of the documents we had requested for the time period of March 2011 to March 2012. As you can recall from my testimony last week, that CSTICA had promised our auditors that they had complete records for the time period of March 2011 to March 2012. However, when they turned the records over to us and we did a sample, half of the documents were missing. Nevertheless, our auditors are now reviewing this new disk to ascertain whether it contains complete and accurate copies of the records we requested. Now, regarding the bulk of the records, those prior to February 2010, we still do not know what happened to them. CSTICA tells us that it tells our auditors in Kabul that they have located additional hard copies of the records, including some prior to February 2010, which we intend to examine. Let me just say at this point, CSTICA's handling of its records is deeply troubling, and to us raises questions about their ability to perform this serious function. It appears it has to take two congressional hearings, 6 months of IG requests, an interim audit report, a management alert letter, and my personal meeting with every senior military official in Afghanistan before CSTICA deigns to seriously take our request for records as something they should respond to. We find that very troubling. Now, let us also update you on other developments since our last testimony last week. CSTICA informed us of changes to their plans to transfer responsibilities to the Afghan government. Subsequent to our testimony, CSTICA now says they are going to revise the amount of funding it plans to provide directly to the Afghan government from 2/3 of total funding to 1/3. The time frame for transferring that fuel has also changed. It appears in a meeting, again, subsequent to our testimony, that the Afghan Ministry of Defense has said they can't handle this new mission until March of 2013. Although we think this is a good move to delay, we're surprised that apparently CSTICA never talked to the Afghan Ministry about this important function until subsequent to the hearing. These developments indicate that CSTICA is perhaps approaching the transition to Afghan-run logistics more cautiously than before. Unfortunately, we know from our audit work and the work of others, including the Army Audit Agency, that CSTICA has struggled with direct assistance in the past. As I mentioned last week, the Army Audit Agency reported in February 2012 that SIGAR's standard operating procedure for making direct contributions to the Afghan National Security Forces did not provide solid quality control process. SIGAR itself reported in 2011 that SIGAR's efforts to help the Afghan Ministry of Interior develop and implement a personnel management system to account for the Afghan National Police workforce and payroll was unsuccessful. Providing direct assistance to the Afghan government is a critical part of handling responsibility for the Afghan reconstruction effort over to the Afghans. But moving forward with direct contributions in face of the serious problems that SIGAR itself has encountered in its fuel programs reconfirms our belief that transferring funding responsibility in January is doubling down on a very risky bet. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member. I'm open to any questions.
Thank you. We'll now recognize the Honorable Mr. Estevez.
Thank you. Chairman Chaffetz, Ranking Member Tierney, distinguished members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to appear before you to review the findings of the Special Inspector General for Afghanistan Reconstruction's interim report on the subject of Afghan National Army petroleum, oil, and lubricants. I would like to note that Lieutenant General Bash and I have submitted a joint statement for the record. I would also like to note that we appreciate the work of the Special Inspector General and that across the Department of Defense, to include that in our deployed forces in Afghanistan, we are committed to working with the Special Inspector General to strengthen our processes in Afghanistan and to protect the taxpayers' dollars. Before addressing the issues raised by the interim report, it is important that we put our actions with regard to Afghan forces in context. It is critically important that we build Afghan force capability and capacity. This is the key to a stable, secure Afghanistan, an Afghanistan that is not a safe haven for extremists like al-Qaeda that threaten this nation. As part of the process to build Afghan military capability, we must also build Afghan force sustainment capabilities. Developing the ability to provide petroleum, oil, and lubricants, or POL in the military vernacular, is a critical part of that process. I would like to address the Special Inspector General's concerns with the Combined Security Transition Command Afghanistan's ability to fully account for POL provided to Afghan forces and the statements that officials shredded all Afghan fuel-related financial records from October 2006 to February 2011. And I will note that I just heard new information regarding that. However, I will stand by our statement that to the best of our knowledge, no documents have been shredded and records have been appropriately maintained, and I will say that electronic copies are valid records of, so if a record was shredded, there is a valid electronic copy. And that is to the best of our knowledge today. We will continue to provide the Special Inspector General with all documents relevant to this audit as we accomplish our ongoing mission in theater. To date, we have collected 97% of the documents requested by the Special Inspector General. These documents include scanned copies of delivery tickets, invoices, and acceptance forms dating back to 2006. Ongoing logistics training for the Afghan forces includes developing within the proper procedures for fuel ordering and receipt and the verification of the quantity and quality of fuel delivered. Our current process requires Afghan security force units to submit the appropriate requisition and consumption forms, or fuel orders are refused. Afghan security force personnel, working under the guidance of their coalition advisors, process fuel order documents by verifying the quantity of fuel authorized and comparing it with fuel requested to ensure units do not exceed their fuel allocations. The quantity and quality of fuel delivered to Afghan security force sites is verified through the reconciliation of appropriate forms. The NATO training mission has refined its method for estimating fuel funding levels for fiscal years 2014 to 2018. They used 1 year of consumption data from August 2011 to July 2012 to establish an annual requirements baseline. From that baseline, using simple trend analysis and taking into account expected operational tempo increases, planned equipment fieldings, and seasonal weather factors, they developed future year fuel requirements. To improve accountability of supplies, the NATO training mission issued a memorandum in April 2011 prior to the audit, to the Afghan Ministry of Defense, noting that it would apportion fuel based only on vehicles that were properly accounted for by the Ministry and coalition forces. The NATO training mission also issued a fragmentary order in May 2012 directing coalition personnel at Afghan security force sites to report fuel storage capacity at all 46 Afghan force fixed location fuel storage sites. This data enables NATO training mission to compare quantity of fuel requested with capacity of potential storage in either fixed storage fuel tanks or mobile fuel transportation assets. To further improve accountability of fuel and provide closer oversight, we are also consolidating the number of fuel delivery sites. In accordance with the overall campaign objectives, the NATO training mission is currently working with its Afghan partners in the Ministry of Defense to transition fuel management responsibility in a controlled, conditions-based manner, phased conditions-based manner. Next year, the NATO training mission will transfer responsibility for only one-third of the estimated 2013 fuel budget to the Afghan security force. The remaining fuel budget will remain under the direct control of the NATO training mission. To mitigate any financial risk, disbursements for funds for future Afghan security force fuel orders will occur quarterly and will be subject to the outcome of quarterly financial audits to ensure responsible use of funds. In addition to the specific actions mentioned above, the NATO training mission is instituting a number of initiatives to strengthen Afghan security force fuel and POL program. First, the training mission has formed an assistant minister-level bulk fuel transfer executive committee with members from the NATO training mission and key Afghan ministries. Second, the NATO training mission, with the assistance of the U.S. Central Command Joint Theater Support Contracting Command, will advise Ministry of Defense acquisition personnel on the development of an enforceable contracting mechanism. Finally, the NATO training mission has requested the Defense Logistics Agency experts to review the NATO training mission procedures and provide feedback on how it can improve operations. Again, we want to thank the Special Inspector General for its work and this committee for its work. Ultimately, the aim of the collective effort is to ensure that Afghan Security Force POL operations are implemented properly while judiciously managing taxpayer resources. We continue to work hard to improve our oversight and management of this critical area. I look forward to your questions.
Thank you. And my understanding, again, as you stated, is that it was a joint statement with General Bass. So we'll now recognize Mr. Sampler for 5 minutes. Do it again.
And now. Perfect. Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to
Yeah, we can hear him. We through the speakers we can hear him, but okay. All right. If we could just say sorry, we have to share that microphone. Thank
you. Are we doing better now?
Yes.
Perfect. Afghanistan is and has been a difficult place to do assistance work. USAID's development assistance for Afghanistan continues to remain a critical component of our core U.S. national security objective there, which is to disrupt, dismantle, and defeat al-Qaeda, and to prevent Afghanistan from ever again becoming a safe haven from which extremists can attack the United States and our allies. USAID's efforts are part of a whole-of-government, civil-military effort to advance this strategic objective. Together, we are committed to promoting the development of a stable Afghanistan by partnering with the Afghan government and the Afghan people to solidify a foundation of sustainable economic growth and effective, legitimate governance. I have been working on and often in Afghanistan since 2002 in both civilian and military capacities for the U.S. government. I have worked as a representative of an international NGO, and I served for about 2 years as the Chief of Staff of the U.N. Assistance Mission in Afghanistan. So I do have personal experience with the challenges of implementing assistance programs in such a difficult environment, and I've seen the benefits of our assistance programs in Afghanistan. Under the Taliban, less than 9,000 boys and almost no girls had access to education. Today, more than 8 million children, more than a third of whom are girls, are enrolled in school. This is important because now there's a generation of young men and women graduating with critical thinking skills that will make them better citizens and more resilient in their opposition to malicious doctrines of the Taliban or others. In 2002, only 9% of Afghans had access to even the most basic health care. Today, that number is over 60%, and life expectancy at birth has risen by almost 20 years. Furthermore, maternal mortality and infant mortality have both dropped significantly. And finally, our work in energy has helped triple the number of Afghans with access to reliable electricity, which has enabled the economic growth in the country. With USAID support, Afghanistan's national power utility has increased its revenues by approximately 50% every year since 2009, reducing the needed Afghan government subsidy to that organization from $170 million to approximately $30 million last year. Of course, our ultimate goal is to work ourselves out of a job by enabling Afghanistan to stand on its own two feet without direct foreign assistance. To that end, USAID has been working through select ministries in the Afghan government since the previous administration. This work is commonly referred to as government-to-government or on-budget support assistance. I should note that on-budget assistance encompasses a range of mechanisms, such as funds provided to and through the World Bank's Afghan Reconstruction Trust Fund, or the ARTF, as well as specific project assistance that we provide directly to and through ministries and agencies of the Government of Afghanistan. USAID has been constantly learning and reforming our operations in Afghanistan over the course of our engagement there. Oversight and accountability is an area where USAID's leadership has focused extensively throughout the agency, and in particular with respect to Afghanistan. Protecting taxpayer resources is a vital concern to USAID, and we've established a variety of layered measures to ensure that our programs are cost-effective and are having the intended and the expected impacts. We're mindful that as stewards of the U.S. government and taxpayer funds, that we serve as their representatives as we provide this assistance to the people of Afghanistan. USAID works to ensure that the ministries and agencies to whom we provide assistance are capable of implementing the desired programs, achieving the desired results, and doing so in a way that is transparent and fiscally responsible. USAID accomplishes this through a system of pre-award assessments, mitigating measures, financial controls, and rigorous monitoring and evaluation. As part of the financial controls, USAID maintains control of funds throughout the life cycle of a project. We work with the Afghan government to develop projects that are going to achieve specific outcomes, and we allow funds to be distributed only when certain benchmarks have been met. This ensures that the funds are accounted for and that we achieve the outcomes that are critical for our success. Another layer of oversight and accountability is provided by the multiple independent oversight bodies that review our programs. These, of course, include your own Government Accountability Office, the USAID Inspector General, and the Special Inspector General for Afghan Reconstruction. They complete numerous audits of our programs in Afghanistan every year that complement and reinforce our own efforts to ensure that taxpayer dollars are effectively used. And I should add, we welcome the oversight and the discipline that these reviews impose on our work. A number of the reviews actually have been requested by our staff. Finally, I know well that there have been significant sacrifices made by the American people in support of sustainability and stability in Afghanistan. We are under no illusions about the challenges that we face, but these challenges call for exercising diligence in how we operate as we carefully and deliberately transition to an Afghan-led process which meets our standards of achievement and of accountability. Our mission of defeating terrorists and denying them a safe haven remains critical to U.S. national security. The programs implemented by USAID are making important contributions towards that goal by helping Afghanistan to stand on its own. I look forward to answering any questions you may have, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. I appreciate all of your statements. I will now recognize myself for 5 minutes. And Mr. Estevez and General Bash, help me understand who is ultimately responsible for the POL in Afghanistan. I mean, where does that boat go through the two of you? Who at the Department of Defense is responsible for this?
Let me just, if you were talking POL for U.S. forces, I would say I have ultimate responsibility in that regard. We're talking about for building capacity for the Afghans, so it's a shared responsibility. We both have oversight of our contracting capability that is in Afghanistan that supports both our forces and supports SISTICA and its mission. SISTICA is operating in a training capacity, so you know their ultimate responsibility is through the command structure there.
How the special inspector for Afghan reconstruction, I think he's honest, sincere. He's trying to do the right thing. It takes months and months and months and months. As he said, a couple congressional inquiries. With all due respect, I'd rather not be sitting here with you today. I'd much rather have you provide the documentation to him and be able to reconcile the books. He says there's no documents, that they found some of them now. Why is there such a challenge? Why does it take so long to get some what should be basic information?
First, let me say that we also do believe that the Special Inspector General is doing great work. It's very helpful work for us and for our mission in Afghanistan. Right now, I think in CSTICA there are 30-some audits going on. Of course, they are also engaged in the mission and training Afghanistan. I will let General Bash talk a little bit about that. So they are working to provide those records.
Have you seen them?
I have not.
Who has seen them?
The folks in Afghanistan that are pulling them and the folks around in
Arsant. When will they have them?
They have provided, as Mr. Sopko said, a disk. They are going through that disk to make sure that they are giving them the right documents. A lot of this is electronic backup records. They did not know, at least to our knowledge again, until September 5th, that there was an allegation of shredding and that documents were not available. And they are working very hard to provide those documents. We expect them to do so.
They were going to take a roughly $350 million line item and bring it up to $55 million. What gave you the confidence that that was an accurate number? Who signed off on that?
Well, Mr. Chairman, ultimately, the commander at CSTICA is responsible for the estimation and the building of the Afghan Army. Myself spent a year in Iraq and numerous visits to Afghanistan. I know you have. The environment is challenging to help them build their institutional capacity, which is really what the core issue here is, trying to make an assessment of when they can start handling this and the training and advisors. And because of the way the mission is developed, they focused on the fighting forces first, and then now they are starting to get to the enablers, which includes logistics. So it brings us to the point of how we have confidence of how much fuel they actually need. And I would say that since this special inspection started in March and April, and the initial report was provided in May, which was the preliminary issues of concern provided to the commander at the time, our review with the commanders there have shown that at that time, the six issues, they have made considerable progress, and I am prepared to share some of those details. But I think that there have been challenges. Just the fact that the Expeditionary Sustainment Command only stood up 9 months ago, because when they recognized that they wanted to start building logistics capacity for the Afghan Army, they said, you know, this is really hard stuff. We need to have the ECPROS from Dover come out, which is the ESC, which has been there for 9 months now. So since that time, since 9 months ago, they've made considerable progress, and that's in parallel with Mr. Sopko's investigation. And I think they've been working with that team. In fact, there's been a SIGAR team member there consistently, and they were meeting weekly, at least initially, and I know there's team members still there. So I think they're working very closely together. Admittedly, there's frustration that it takes time to find the records, I think because of the scale. And when you talk about the
But General, we're talking about increasing funding by $200 million, just this one line item, $200 million annually. This SIGAR is saying there's no basis for this. We don't see any accounting that would justify this in any way, shape, or form. You two gentlemen are saying, yes, there is. Where is it? I think that's a fair and reasonable question to answer. And if there's been progress, please do that. I'm past my time, but feel free to share those answers, and then we'll recognize the gentleman from Massachusetts.
Let me just address the growth of the Afghan Army, the Afghan forces. So it's Afghan Army, police, border police, mm-hmm. The whole group. Mm-hmm. So that has expanded significantly year by year by year. In addition, we're providing substantial pieces of equipment, armored Humvees, pickup trucks, armored pickup trucks and the like, that all consume fuel. We are providing an Air Force capability to the Afghans. I am saying us and our coalition partners in doing this. And as we expand sites, that of course also expands the requirement for fuel at those sites and for using that equipment. And the Afghan forces are taking more and more the responsibility for engaging in combat. So they are out there using that fuel.
How much of the fuel are they paying for? How much of the fuel are we paying for?
I believe right now we are probably there funding their fuel requirement.
100%.
I have to get you that. I really need to get you that for the record, sir, but I believe right now that we're probably fully funding their fuel requirement.
General, you said there were some other developments. I just wanted to give you an opportunity to expand that thought.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I'll try to be brief here. But in May, when the SIGAR provided the preliminary issues of concern to the command, there were six primary issues, and I'll briefly cover those. And if you want more, we can provide it. But at the time, they said that there needed to be a complete inventory of storage capacity, also perform an assessment of short-lived consumption needs. Since that time, NTN has actually reduced the number of sites from 191 delivery sites down to 191 from almost 800, and they're going to 68. So the scale of the number of sites for delivery has shrunk significantly, which makes it a lot easier. They've issued a direction to collect data on fuel storage capacity, and today they do know how much capacity each of these sites, 46 sites, have, and they know the million liters capacity. So that gives them an idea of when they push fuel out, how much they can actually accept. They've also refined the processes for determining consumption. So they're just beginning this process, and so we don't have any success evidence that I have at this point. But they're using NATO standard fuel consumption formulas for vehicles. They're also using NATO operational planning factors that are accepted. And so, for the first issue, I feel confident that they're making progress. Perhaps still ways to go there, but I think they have a process in place. The second issue talks about they should establish a contract vehicle that includes more stringent provisions regarding fuel quality, quantity, and contractor performance. They now have a new four-step process. I won't go into details on that, but it is a new process. Based on this process, in August and July, they had three cases of invoices that were rejected because the Afghans weren't following that particular process. So we do have evidence that that's beginning to work. And finally, they're looking at coming up with an indefinite delivery contract to replace the current blanket purchase agreement, which was one of the suggestions I think that the SIGAR made at the time. That has not been done yet, but they're moving forward in that regard. And the third issue, as far as ordering and purchasing, they're requiring that SISICA account for all fuel orders. And today they are doing 100% reconciliation of those fuel orders, which we have confirmed with the theater. On the fourth one, which was regard to documentation, again, this comes back to the new four-step process where they have to get the fuel orders, which is the Form 14s that the Afghans use. That goes all the way through the reconciliation, which is the Form 32 at the end of the process. And they're trying to put maturity in the trainers and advisors that are advising the Afghans, the Overwatch, trying to help them understand how to do that process with integrity. And the final two, the last issue, complete info on ANA PLO purchase is not available. The suggestion was to require them to perform monthly reconciliations, which I already mentioned that they're doing 100% today now, which wasn't necessarily the case when the SIGAR brought this to their attention in May. And finally, suggest to revise the Afghan Ministry of Defense Decree 4.6 to establish minimum proficiency requirements for the Afghans. That has not been completed yet. It's in progress. Obviously, this is one that the Afghans have to change their policy direction. The advisors are working with the Afghans right now to help them understand what changes need to be made, and hopefully in the future the Afghans will make that change so that what the advisors are trying to teach them, they have overarching guidance to follow. Thank you.
Thank you. I now recognize the gentleman from Massachusetts, Mr. Turney, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
For as the rest of the time afternoon, as he may consume, yes.
So, Mr. Sopko, what do you say to all this?
Sorry. A couple things. First of all, any of the efforts that the General mentioned to improve oversight and accountability, we fully support. The problem is where the rubber meets the road. My auditors, and you have to remember, they were reviewing CSTCA's response as late as August and September. They found no evidence of actual consumption data reports being used to estimate fuel requirements. Now, that's a key, and that's the problem I think we're seeing with CSTCA. CSTCA is using purchase data, not consumption data. We know what we purchased. We know what we paid for. The question is, do we know what the Afghans got and do they need it? And we're not seeing consumption data. Now, Mr. Tierney, let me go back to the question that the Chairman asked about the records. It's not just that they couldn't find the records for us and our audit was delayed 6 months and that we had to narrow the scope from 4 years to 1 year. What it really shows is they didn't have access to the records that they are now claiming they have access to, that they are using on a regular basis to determine if the Afghans are stealing the fuel. And what we would posit is that the total confusion of where the records were, we asked a simple question to give us the records you are using to oversee the Afghans' usage. They couldn't find them for 6 months. We are really concerned, and I don't know how else we could express it other than to say, do not proceed with cutting a blank check in January until you are sure you have a program in place that you, CSTCA, is using. The issue, we have had problems with CSTCA and CSTCA records in the past. I mentioned and alluded to it in my opening statement and my written statement. In January of this year, we had a delay in audit on the number of vehicles that CSTCA was using and had purchased for the Afghan military by 4 months because CSTCA didn't have an accounting of how many vehicles they were actually fueling. We later found out, and we saved over $5 million in fuel because it turned out CSTCA was giving fuel to the Afghans for vehicles that had been destroyed. My auditors tell me to this date, CSTCA is still paying for fuel to fuel trailers, to fuel non-functional vehicles and non-existing vehicles. So, Mr. Tierney, my response is, I'll use President Reagan's terminology, and I think the Chairman did, trust but verify.
Thank you. So, General, I'm concerned that we have this estimate for $200 million additional dollars a year at a time when your people couldn't access or weren't accessing the records. So, you know, without that kind of consumption information as to what was being used, I'm a little curious as to how they got this estimate they were going to need $200 million more next year.
First, I would say that I think the challenge that CSTCA has is there's a difference between the detailed end records, which are the consumption data and the forms that the Afghans do, and the trend analysis that they're doing from a macro perspective of what they're using. Certainly,
can you explain that to me? You think that to make a trend analysis, you don't need to have a good core base of information of data?
The individual transactions, so it's more what I'm making a distinction between the retail and the wholesale level. You know, so if you have, you know, hundreds of bases out there and thousands of vehicles and generators, you know, what goes in each one individual tank and what's used is a huge challenge. And that level,
less so if you have the records indicating it, you just add them up.
Right. So at the supply level, that's where they're doing the trend analysis to understand what the FOBs are using. And they're using a trend analysis, as I previously mentioned. As far as the increases,
you know, can I get back? Maybe I'm obtuse here or something like that. I don't think you've answered my question, but you can maybe bear with me and try again so even I get it on that. You know, I would think you need to know, you know, how many storage tanks exist, how many vehicles, and what capacity per vehicle there are in order for you to get a feel for what is needed collectively and base by base before you can make any trend analysis going forward. You have to know where you start in order to trend forward. Is that not making sense?
You are absolutely right, sir. And in fact, when this SIGAR started, that information was not readily available, and today it is based on
the information. But it appears not to have been available when the trend analysis was made and the projection for $200 million additional money was made.
Unfortunately, I can't talk about the timing. I mean, they've been making considerable progress.
Well, let me say it this way, because the Inspector General knew that they were asking for $200 million more when the documents were still not found. So now the documents have subsequently been found. I think it stands to reason that they didn't use those documents to establish their baseline on which the trend was then set.
But let me try to answer you, Congressman Tierney.
Before you do this, Mr. Sopko, am I off base here? Does that sound reasonable to you?
You're absolutely correct, and that's our concern. And I'm happy to give more detail because we were provided, C. Sticker provided their spreadsheet that they used it, and it didn't include consumption data. So, my auditors on the ground have been doing this for 9 months, and what they're saying is they're not using consumption data; they're using purchase data.
Now, Mr. Esposito, if you care.
So what they have done is they've looked at the last year. They have used NATO consumption standards against the type of vehicles that the Afghans have, and that's vehicles ranging from, again, armored type pickups to armored Humvees to helicopters and aircraft, generators, et cetera. So they have a year's worth of data. They use NATO consumption trends against that. They look at what the expected operational tempo is, because obviously if you have a vehicle and it's not being used, then there's no consumption. If it's used X amount, there's X amount. If I'm going to go out on patrol more because we're pulling back and we're expecting them to take the lead, that gives you another calculation. All that is into the calculation on how much fuel we need to buy for the Afghans and the growth of the force. So we're fielding new vehicles into that mix. All that went into the trend analysis to calculate how much budget, as well as a calculation of what it's going to cost. Obviously, price of fuel fluctuates.
One of the trailers and things like that that were in now calculated number, you know, things that don't move and don't use energy that were somehow calculated in that base?
Sir, the best that we can figure on that one is that, in talking to the commanders out there, is that today they've done a reconciliation with the Afghan books, if you will, and they do not provide fuel for vehicles that don't require fuel. There are trailers that do have pumps and engines on them to, you know, pump water and that sort of thing that perhaps are on the records that they get an allotment for fuel based on the NATO standards. But the commander has told us that if that was happening previously, it is not happening today because they've gone through and they now know exactly how many vehicles are on the Afghan records, and they have oversight into. And of course, that changes all the time based on losses and whatnot.
Mr. Sopko, are you satisfied that the one-year records that are said to be have been used were accurate for that 1 year? And do you think that that's a complete enough basis on which to make projections?
No, we are not.
Why?
And again, let me. Maybe the best way to do this is look at the our vehicle work showed that at least 1,600 Afghan military vehicles that are not operational are still getting fuel. And I'd like to also refer to an audit report that I mentioned, January 12, 2012, and just read from the findings. And it said, and again, this is the one where C. Sticker had to ask us to delay doing our field work, because C. Sticker reported it could not readily provide the documentation required to address our questions and was in the process of conducting a nationwide field inventory. After they did that inventory and allowed us in, they said, the U.S. was providing fuel for destroyed vehicles. As a result, C. Sticker saved over $370,000, And if you estimated it in 200,000 liters, and if you estimated it would amount to over $5 million in savings. We're not comfortable with the number they're giving based upon our prior work there. We don't feel they know what they're buying and what's being consumed. And the simple answer is, do you remember the chart I showed you about how the system was supposed to work? We put it up. There's a form called a MOD, Ministry of Defense. That's a form. It's a very good form that the Afghans are supposed to fill out, which talks about monthly consumption report. As of last week, when we got a report from CSTICA in the field, they're saying they're still collecting those consumption reports, and they're reaching out the Afghans to try to find them. So if they're right now trying to find the consumption reports, how can they justify their budget, which was submitted, I think, a few months ago?
You care to take a shot at that one, Lieutenant General?
How about if I do try to take a shot at that? Couple
I'm sure the General's happy with that.
We work together. I think, as far as the vehicles and, we do not dispute that we had problems with this in the past. We think we were better today.
The key is, I hope you don't mind a conversation.
Yeah, certainly, sir.
The key seems to be you had a problem at the time that you were making your estimates and your projections. That's what, I don't mind if you had a problem in the past, but if you had a problem at the time you were then finding some reason to make projections and trend analysis on it, that's what I have a problem with. They can't be very trustworthy if they're not set on solid ground.
The trend analysis is done in the July-August time frame, so I believe we're okay there. But I would
According to Mr. Sopko, you're still getting information in August and September.
So, may I suggest on how we did our trend analysis, and his auditors may have already looked at this, but I believe that we need to get CSTICA and his auditors together again to walk through that process and hopefully find a way forward on that. We're satisfying the Special Inspector General. Again, they're providing us useful help in doing this. And I'll go back to, back in January and earlier last year, one of the reasons, as General Bash alluded to, that we deployed an active Army Expeditionary Support Command to CSTICA, and we have one in Afghanistan supporting our own forces, in order to train Afghans how to do this and to do this in conjunction with them, was because we needed the pros from Dover in order to get in there and work this process. And so it's an evolving process as we go forward in doing this. So we do believe we have the right trend analysis, but we'll be happy to have our folks work that with the Inspector General.
Thank you.
Now I recognize the gentleman from Massachusetts, Mr. Lynch.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I understand about trend analysis from one year to the next, but in order to have a good feel for that, you've got to have a good reference point. And the reference point would be consumption. Knowing how everything else goes in Afghanistan, just hearing what I've just heard and in the previous hearing as well, I don't get a lot of confidence that we know what the hell we're doing. If we're just using a NATO model, and we don't know we don't know how many vehicles we have, we don't know how much fuel they're using. I do know how things go in Afghanistan, and I'm not encouraged by that. And so we're just adding $200 million to what we used last year, and we don't know if we were being robbed last year, but I suspect the odds are we were. This is crazy. This is crazy. So, Mr. Estevez, you said in your opening statement that you have all the records, they've been properly kept, and the man to your right, the Special Inspector General, says he has no records. And you're both under oath. So what am I supposed to believe here? I mean, from what and all of our members have been over to Afghanistan a bunch of times, we know how things are going over there. I mean, how do I get that? All the records are there. They have been kept in order. And by the way, we have been tracking this thing since 2006. Everybody is fast-forwarding to 2011, 2010. What happened back in 2006? Have we been doing this since 2006? We are counting vehicles and we have been tracking consumption? Have we been doing that? General? Mr. Testifies?
Well, to sort of address your most previous one, as you well know, the surge and the buildup in Afghanistan didn't occur until the last couple of years. So the challenges prior to that
were
obviously.
But we know what the surge was. So if we had a reference point before that, then you account for the surge, so you have a known point. So I don't want to fast forward and make believe we arrived in Afghanistan in 2010. I don't want to do that. We've been there for a long, long time. And so what were we doing then? We've been there 10, 11 years. What were we doing since the beginning? Have we been just pulling the number out of a hat? Because that's the way it seems, that we're just taking an arbitrary number, and God knows we have to justify next year's budget, so increase it by a substantial amount. You know, it's just it's unacceptable, number one, but it's not going to continue. We got to get to the bottom of this. So let me go back. You say all the records are in order. We have everything. They've been kept in due diligence. So how did we figure out how many vehicles we have and how much those vehicles consume? Mr. Testifies.
Let me address a couple of things there. First, let me, as General Pash was alluding to, 2006, there was not a drive to a 352,000-man force, Afghan force. That didn't start in a concerted effort until the last three years or so. So there was a change in focus and mission in the midst of that, and push of equipment in doing so. When we say all the records are in order, I said we have the records, we are pulling the records going back to 2006. We have evidence that that is the case, that we have them on electronic.
Well, how come Mr. Sopko doesn't have them then? How come he sits there under oath and tells me he has nothing and you say we got everything and it is all in order? How do we get that?
We are providing those to his auditors. Hopefully at the end of this, and it's the Department's belief at this point, that he will have the records that he needs.
When is he going to get the records? Because you're really,
Our folks in Sistika, sir, are working with his auditors as we speak in providing him those records. And
Mr. Sopko, how are you doing on the records? Are you getting the records?
They have provided, as for the records in the 2011 to 2012 framework, time frame, they have given us a CD and they said the records are there. We are reviewing to see if they are there.
That is for 1 year, though, right?
That is for 1 year. Remember, that was the year where they said they had all of the records. And when we did the survey and we pulled, they didn't have 50% of the records. Now, that doesn't mean the records are complete. You recall from last week's testimony, when we pulled it, we could only find 4 complete packages, which had all of the appropriate forms you would want and were all signed. As for the prior records that were shredded, and there is no doubt that they were shredded. I mean, 2 Air Force captains have admitted to my investigators they shredded the records. Now, I'm not saying they did them for evil purposes, but they were shredded. They claim they made electronic copies. We haven't found those, and we haven't had a chance to look at those electronic versions. But the records were shredded.
Now, Mr. Testifies, you're saying not there was no shredding going on. We got, this is a good hearing. This is pretty good. Okay, we got one guy says we have 2 Air Force folks that have testified that they shredded the documents, and you tell me none of the documents were shredded and they're all properly maintained.
If I could,
yeah, it's like a parallel universe here.
I'll concede that if the special investigator has people who said they shred records, the records were probably shredded. That does not mean that records were destroyed. Electronic copy of record is valid copy of the record.
Well, hard copy was destroyed.
That's what I'm hearing, sir.
Sir, I'd also say that the CSTICA was focused on the initial request of records, which which, as the special investigator said, that 50% was required provide right away. Over the past 4 or 5 months, they've provided now 97% of those records. Now,
that's what you say, right?
Of the requested.
You're saying 97%. Is that what you're getting, Mr. Sopko?
I beg to disagree with the general. Our initial request, and I'm happy to go through the timeline. We opened the audit on February 13, 2012. February 21st, we held our first conference, entrance conference, with CSTIC, and we explained to them what was the scope of the audit. On April 3rd, we
And what did you describe as the scope of your audit?
Well, it was multiple 4 years of records.
Okay, good.
On April 3rd, we made the initial request for fuel order documents to CSTICA. At that meeting, the CSTICA fuel ordering officer informed us that he did not have supporting documentation for any of the earlier fuel orders, period. No supporting documentation.
Okay.
Because
let's
were shredded.
Let's stop right there. All right, Mr. Estevez and Lieutenant General Bash, what do you say to that about the previous years? We're not talking about the 1 year. We're talking about the other 3 years of the 4 year request.
I don't doubt that the officer in question said that he had heard.
Do you have those records?
We believe we've given the records that the Special Inspector General is looking for on the disk. We also have records.
He's asking for 4 years. Are you giving him 4 years? Earlier you said the disk was 1 year.
Sir, we're giving him the records that his auditors requested. They asked for records by number, and we are giving him the records that he asked for. We have records stored going back in time, and I can't say what's in these boxes, but we've moved all the financial records as time evolved in Afghanistan back to Shaw Air Force Base for all the records for the war.
I just want to, from this point forward, I just want to make sure everybody understands when we're looking for records, we're looking for 4 years' worth of records. We want 4 years, not 1 year. So when we say we got all the records, 97% of the records, I'm hearing you have 97% of the 4 years that we're looking for in the audit. That's what I'm hearing.
We have 97% of the records, specific records that the Special Inspector General has asked for. If they are looking for other specific records, we will, inside the Department of Defense, go and find those records for him.
Okay, I'm sure I'm exceeding my time.
You're not the first, so.
Okay. Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, can I just
please,
because I don't want to add to the confusion, but I think what the confusion is, and then. On April 18th, remember, April 3rd, we're told the 4 years of records are destroyed. April 18th, that same fuel ordering officer says, you can't get the earlier records, but we do have records for 1 year. That's March. So that's what we're talking about, the 1 year. So
Mr. Estevez,
97% is the 1 year.
Let's stop right there. So, Mr. Estevez, after you told him you can't get the previous years, you can get the 1 year. Are we skipping over that? Is that what you're telling me in this 97% response? You're skipping over the part where he asked for 4 years, and you're hearing, well, we don't have the other 3 years, but we'll give you 1 year. Is that what's causing the confusion here? Because we want 4 years.
I hope not, but I will say that neither General Bash or I are privy to the discussions between his auditor and the levels in CSTICA that they were dealing with.
I'm talking about the original response that asked for 4 years of records. And your guys are probably saying, well, we got them to back off on the first three they wanted. We told them we didn't have them. We told them we had 1 year. And so now that you're dealing with a much narrower request, but that's not the entire request.
Sir, if the Special Inspector General asks for records, we will go find those records for him.
Okay. We're talking 4 years. All right. I'll yield back.
Thank the gentleman. Now recognize myself. One of the allegations, if you'll call it that, or one of the concerns, probably is a better word, is that you had not been working with the Afghan ministry. Mr. Sopko mentioned that in his opening statement. How would you react to that?
Well, having been an advisor myself, Mr. Chairman, there is a team that works with the ministry every day. to help them build that institutional capacity. I wasn't assigned to Afghanistan in that regard. However, there is no doubt in my mind, once they started to, they decided to build the logistics capacity, which, and they have a whole plan of 8 different ways of building that enabler, they start to work with the ministers to help them understand how to do logistics.
Mr. Sopko, did you want to add anything to that? That concern about talking to the ministers?
Well, all I can say is that in the latest, they have set up a meeting which we applaud, but it was only set up recently. I believe in the August, well, actually it was set up before your hearing, but I think it met after the last hearing, so it would be last week or early this week, at which time the Afghan ministry, I think, was first time it looks like they were consulted, and they said, we're not prepared to start January 1st. So that just, and that was a briefing that CSTICA gave us and some documents they gave us and PowerPoints just this week about this meeting. So we're just saying, it looks like, now again, we had, that wasn't the scope of our audit.
Let me get the, we're going to have to pick up the pace here. General, how are you, I mean, you say there's, you're meeting daily, the Inspector General saying you met for the first time since we had our last hearing, which was a week ago.
Well, I think it's a matter of a level. I mean, there's engagements consistently.
Are they ready to handle this in January?
Sir, as, you know, sitting here in Washington, D.C. and talking to the commander out there, their plan is to have a phased approach based on conditions. So if they're
based
not ready.
Based on your assessment of the conditions today, and I think it's been bunched back to March of 2013.
In fact, that's what we heard this today, and that's, that tells me that they are not ready on 1 January, and so now they're going to move that to March to make a new assessment.
All right, let me keep going. You talked about in an ongoing effort to do a quarterly review as the ministry starts to take over. Again, I seriously question we should even do that, but at what point, what is the threshold? What is the level of acceptable, what is the threshold by which we say this is unacceptable, this is acceptable? I mean, where do you say, well, they got 80% of it right, so we'll just keep going. Where is that threshold?
Sir, I would think that to a certain extent there's going to be some commander's judgment in balancing the needs of the mission to grow the Afghans.
I guess as a follow-up, we'd love to know what sort of metrics are going to be in place so we can look at it objectively. We're not doing this subjective analysis. I think that's what the inspector is looking for, and I think that's what Congress is looking for as well. If somebody did shred the documents, what should happen to them?
Obviously, we should investigate the cause of the shredding, why they were shredded, and we should hold people accountable.
I guess I'm questioning what would be holding people accountable. What
I mean, that will have to, it will depend on.
If you can perhaps follow up on this, was there any justification? I mean, one of the things that popped up in this interim report was this $20 million for firewood. Is there any justification for that?
Well, in fact, we did follow up with that on the commanders, and as you probably are aware, firewood is the primary source of energy in Afghanistan rural. And in the Afghan Army, every DFAC, every dining facility has a fire that helps them cook. That's just how they operate there, and so they use the estimates of fuel. You know, wood is as important as gas. And so that's the nature of the requirement. We don't necessarily question the requirement, but again, it's the situation of you know, $20 million of firewood in Afghanistan right now because of deforestation. There's only like 1 or 2% of the country that has, and so the price of firewood has no doubt gone up because of demand. But they've told us that they have you know, procedures in place similar to other commodities. To track the requirements for firewood and make assessments about those needs.
I guess that's the same concern, because when the Inspector General's office went in there and asked for the assessment, how did you come up with this number? I'll let Mr. Sopko fill in the blank on what they said.
They basically told our auditors, Mr. Chairman, we don't know, we don't have the records, we just pay it.
So, General, you're sitting in my seat. What do you do with that? You call a general up here and ask him to help answer it, and what's the answer to that?
I can appreciate that, and we read that testimony, and yesterday I asked the commander about it, and he said that they have the commander in charge now. They said they have records that give them confidence that the requirements.
When will we have those records?
Well, they're working with a special investigation.
No, I want a date from you, General. When is the Inspector General going to have those records? What's reasonable? If they have them, yeah. Right? If they know they have them, just send them over. I mean, FedEx probably doesn't work in Afghanistan like it does in Provo, Utah, but nevertheless, when is he going to get those records? You're being told they have them, so it shouldn't be that hard.
Well, again, you know, Mr. Sopko has said we've given him a disk. He's going through that disk.
I want the firewood records. Where are the firewood records?
All I can say, Mr. Chairman, is that we will take that for action and
sir, you know, with all due respect, I'm looking for a date. Yeah. Give me a date. What's a reasonable date?
It's really, we cannot answer that question sitting here at a table in Washington, Chairman Chaffetz. There's a lot of other things going on in Afghanistan.
Will you commit to give me a date within a week?
I will commit to giving you a date, sir.
Within a week? Is that fair?
Within a week.
Very good. Thank you. I need to talk quickly about disbarment. One of the allegations is that the disbarment process is not working. The Inspector General, in a letter to myself and the Ranking Member Tierney, identifies, I believe it's 43 contractors that have not necessarily been put on the disbarment, and that this process has a backlog. Can you give us your perspective on that?
I can. SIGAR has referred 122 individuals and entities to the Army with recommendations. 52 were received prior to August. 42 of those folks are already disbarred. 70 referrals were received in the last 45 days, and 59 of those referrals were given after September 4th or on September 4th. There is a due process way that you do a disbarment. It is written into law and into the FAR, the Federal Acquisition Regulation. So we have to follow that process to disbar, and it takes a preponderance of evidence. So there is going to be back and forth on evidence. If everything is in order, the Army can, in this case, the Army happens to be the Suspension Debarment Authority, can disbar within 30 days. Outside of that process, there is the process that this Congress authorized last year in Section 841, which is not contracting with the enemy. And that is not a suspension disbarment process, but we can terminate contracts with folks identified under that. And again, that is done within the CENTCOM chain of command.
What sort of backlog do you have currently?
I can't speak of the total Army level of backlog, but as I just said, they're going through the number that the special investigator just sent over. The Army has total disbarment this year in Afghanistan is 100. That's double what was done in the last 4 years.
And what is the time frame? If the Special Inspector General gives a name, what should happen and what is happening in terms of when does it get to the finish line where a determination is made?
Well, again, it depends on, first, let's suspension debarment has to be in the interest of the Federal Government. It has to follow the Federal Acquisition Regulation in order to do that. If all the evidence lines up properly that they need in order to do this, following due process, they can do it within a 30-day time frame.
And Mr. Sopko, can you give us your perspective on what's happening and not happening in this regard?
Well, Mr. Chairman, I think the question here, and we don't disagree with the Army that they have set up a very good process, but we think that process was set up for the normal run-of-the-mill cases, for cases dealing with U.S. companies or companies here in the United States. What you have here is you have a war. We are in a war zone. We have to move quickly. This has to be a priority. When the Department of Commerce puts an entity, an individual, a company on a list of that's called the entities list, and these are entities and individuals and companies that are tied to our enemies, and we have to stand in line with the other 1,000 cases and there is no priority given to us and no priority given to the fact that these are entities which could actually be getting access to our military bases as we speak, because they have only four debarment officials in the entire United States Army, and only one assigned to this region. And it will usually take a year. That's what the backlog is. All we're saying is you've got a great process, but it was a process set up for a non-war. We're in a war. Let's take it seriously. Let's give suspension and debarment authority to the commanders in the field. Let's give it to the SIGAR, and let's move on this. I mean, I find it very troubling that one branch of the government can list an entity as being identified to the Haqqani organization and the Al-Qaeda, and now we're waiting for a year to debar and suspend them. And particularly in Afghanistan, where we're dealing with subcontractors, that's what the threat is. The system they have in place is a system that's excellent when we're not fighting a war. We're in a war now.
I'll yield my time and recognize the gentleman from Massachusetts.
I only want to follow up on that line of question one time. Secretary, the SIGAR has made a recommendation for a draft regulation to the Office of Management and Budget, but the understanding is that the Department of Defense issued an objection to that. Can you shed some light on that?
Unfortunately, sir, I can. I'll have to look into that. We believe that the process is working. The entity list, by the way, with the Department of Commerce is not a list for suspension debarment. It has nothing to do with it. It is an export control regimen. So that is not the process. However, I will point out that this Congress has given us a number of authorities that we can use, including the requirement to do, when the contract clause is written, and of course that was just given, to manage subcontractors and Section 841, which does allow us to terminate contracts related to contracting with the enemy.
I'm familiar with that.
I know you are, sir.
Having written that, I'm very familiar with it. But the bottom line is, how long does it take to debar somebody, when you're told, or the Department of Defense is told, that this person is working with the Taliban or with the Haqqani group or with Al-Qaeda? I hope you're going to tell me a matter of days, not a matter of months or years.
With proper evidence, and so let's do two things. Again, 841, which you're familiar with, you do not have to suspend a bar. You can use 841 under the authority of the CENTCOM commander to do that. So that can be done with evidence, and that can be done with evidence that's not, can't be used in a suspension disbarment activity, classified evidence. A suspension disbarment activity, separate and distinct from what would be done under 841, can be done within 30 days, given the proper evidence.
Thank you.
Just a little bit more question. Mr. Sopko, did you want to add to anything that was just said there? Want to finish that out.
I would, with all due deference to the Assistant Secretary as a lawyer, I would think, first of all, being listed on the entities list would be grounds for suspension and debarment. And 841, being listed on 841, is not being used currently to suspend and debar people. And the other thing is, once you are on a suspension and debarment list, then international organizations take notice of this also. And that is the other problem. We have international organizations that may be contracting. Of course, we are funding those international organizations. So the suspension and debarment, and I am happy to provide additional legal justification as we did on this matter.
Thank you. And I would also mention that myself and the ranking member, Mr. Tierney, and I are working on a piece of legislation we may be dropping soon to talk about discussing the possibility of pushing this back, the POL, the money going directly to the Afghan government until we can sort this out. One of the deep concerns here is we can't seem to manage it. We can't even seem to get this right. We've been operating in theater for 10 years. We're in the United States of America. We expect that suddenly the Afghan government is going to handle hundreds of millions of dollars and do so in a proficient manner and do so with a great oversight and accountability. It just seems totally unreasonable. There was a reason we invited Mr. Sampler here. I'd like to talk a little bit about USAID, and I'm going to transition here for a moment as we start to try to wrap this up. But Mr. Sampler, we appreciate your work and what USAID is trying to do. I'm actually I've been very supportive of Mr. Shaw and his responsibility as the administrator there at USAID. I think he's a passionate and cares. But one of the deep concerns that I have is that USAID is moving in a direction that is, in essence, less accountability, less oversight, and more direct assistance. And I would point to what this USAID Forward program that was put out, which talks about, quote, to achieve capacity building objectives and using host country systems where it makes sense, and end quote. And in some regards, that sounds good, but we're typically looking at third world countries, developing countries that don't have the assets or the sophistication to necessarily do what we'd like them to do. My general concern is that rather than teaching them how to fish, we're just continuing to hand them fish. In fact, we're trying to expedite that by just handing them more fish at an accelerated rate, more money directly there, not knowing if it actually gets to the finish line, not knowing if it actually achieves what we're trying to achieve. We have trouble getting information from USAID to justify these expenditures as it is, and it seems to me that it would make it even worse. That's exacerbated by the fact that we're at war, that we have, you know, tens of thousands of U.S. troops on the ground in Afghanistan trying to do some very difficult work. Do you have a sense of that's the general concern. Can you give me a sense of how much foreign aid we've given to Afghanistan and how much of that would be categorized in this sort of direct assistance bucket, if you will?
Mr. Chairman, when I, in a previous testimony, I said that it was $15 billion was the assistance that had been delivered to Afghanistan. I cannot at the moment recollect how much of that is direct or what we call on-budget assistance, but I will get you that answer. The number was $15 billion is huge, and as a taxpayer myself, that raises concerns. But I would characterize the way that USAID does this as being a layered defense in the sense that we protect U.S. taxpayer dollars through a number of different mechanisms. And if I could, I'll give you two or three of the examples of how on budget.
One or two would be great. We have to move swiftly. Sorry.
We projectize the money that we give to the government of Afghanistan. That is, we don't give them money and ask what they're going to do with it. We work with the ministry to say the ministry wants to do X. And so it's projectized, and at that point we also provide technical assistance to help break out milestones from that project. If you're going to do X, how do we get halfway and then halfway again and halfway again? And then on those milestones, we identify particular benchmarks that we'll pay for on a cost reimbursable basis. So throughout the life cycle of the project, we control the money. The deal is you're going
The concern is going back to last year, the GAO determined that USAID had failed to conduct appropriate risk assessments prior to granting this a lot of the bilateral aid. Are you telling me that those problems the GAO identified last year have gone away? They've been solved?
Actually, I will if we're talking about the same problems. I pulled the report after I saw the testimony, and I believe the report referred to determinations that we are required to make before any disbursement. And in this case, it was a series of disbursements to the World Bank Afghan Reconstruction Trust Fund. And in that case, there were determinations that were not made. We made some, and then there was a period of time when they were not made. It was brought to our attention through the report, which is, again, one of the reasons we find these reports so valuable. And in the response to the report, the mission director and Sean Carroll, who was our chief of staff at the time, noted that we had been lax in doing those determinations and confirmed that they would be done henceforth.
I guess part of my concern is that under the new Forward initiative for USAID, USAID plans to funnel roughly 30% of U.S. foreign assistance directly to foreign governments and NGOs in the hopes that this more money can you know, quote unquote, build capacity. Yet I don't see examples of where, and maybe, you know, as a follow-up to this, where we can point to something and say, this is how we're becoming more accountable. This is how we're doing more oversight. That's the help that this committee would like. It's one of the concerns with this so-called Forward initiative. And it's an even deeper concern in Afghanistan because I think one of the untold sad stories that we're going to look back here upon on Afghanistan years, decades from now, is the waste, the fraud, the abuse, that we were exacerbating the problem. We were funneling money to the enemy. We were funding the enemy. I mean, the host nation trucking work that my colleague here, Mr. Tierney, did is crystal clear in how problematic it was that we were funding the enemy. And I just fundamentally have a trouble sending money directly to these governments without such sort of accountability metrics in place.
Yeah, Congressman, you articulated two dimensions of this problem. One is the 30% goal across the world, and that is actually an aspirational goal. And I'll note that the 30% is aggregate at the agency level. So if in a particular country it doesn't make sense to even attempt to get to 30%, we won't. There are no disincentives. There are no punishments if mission directors don't reach this goal. It is an aspirational goal. And it's actually in service of good development. Development is one of the few industries, perhaps other than dentists, where we try to put ourselves out of business. And for us to do development
and
right.
Not my dentist, I tell you that.
For us to
trying to put his kids through college is what we're trying to do with our family. But
well, we worked and built the host national capacity, and to not do that would not be to execute our duties as development professionals. But we do recognize that as stewards of taxpayer dollars, we have to do it responsibly. And there are examples in Afghanistan where we've done pre-mission or pre-award assessments, and we've said we will not allow you to do what you've described, but we'll allow you to do something lesser. The Department of Education is an example. The Department of Education wanted us to fund textbooks and training for teachers. Because textbooks can be counted, we actually evaluated the Department of Education and said, you meet a rational standard for being able to, on your own, execute this budget and buy textbooks. We'll give you money, you'll buy textbooks, we'll count the textbooks, and we'll consider it done. We did not believe that the Department of Education reached a level of ability to take the same kind of money and execute teacher training, because it's harder to count the quality and the number of teachers trained. So we're still providing technical assistance to the Ministry of Education so that in months or years ahead, we'll be able then to provide that ministry with a higher level of control and a higher level of autonomy to provide teacher training.
I would appreciate it, and again, I'm not expecting to respond right here at the moment to the details of this, but myself and Chairman Issa on April 26th of this year sent Administrator Shaw a request asking for USAID's internal country assessments. This is also known as the Public Financial Management Risk Assessment Framework, the PFMRAF documents, related to this new direct assist program. But yet USAID and the State Department have refused to provide this list in an unredacted form. I guess what I am asking you to respond to is, will you give us and provide the Congress that information?
Yeah, Congressman, I do know that that process is underway, and your staff have been talking to State and
USAID. Well, the problem is we asked for it in April, and here we are in September, and the process is still underway. I just don't understand why this isn't a photocopying exercise.
Congressman, I'm sorry, I'm not the person who deals with what documents. I'm not familiar with the details of that process. I do know what.
But you were told to say today that we're working on this. Is that the idea?
Congressman, I wasn't told to say. I just know that we are working on it.
Okay. This is one of the core questions that we have. It gives some of the oversight that, or some of the information that we need. Would you please talk to Administrator Shaw and look at this April 26th letter, because we still have not had the proper and full response to that letter.
I'll take that back today.
Thank you. I appreciate that. If the ranking member has no additional questions, I wanted to provide you each, very brief, because we've gone exceptionally long, an opportunity to give a closing comment, and then we will conclude this hearing. We'll start with you, Mr. Sampler, then we'll just kind of work down the list.
Thank you, and I will be very brief. I think at this committee it's an opportunity to reinforce the importance that oversight and accountability does play in what USAID does. A large part of our work that's seen is seen to be humanitarian in nature. It's providing education, it's providing opportunities for women, it's providing health and benefits to the people of Afghanistan. but a tremendous amount of our work is done beneath the surface, so to speak, which does involve the kinds of oversight and the kinds of accountability that I think your committee and certainly SIGAR, GAO, and our own Inspectors General expect of us. So it was not gratuitous when I said in my opening remarks that we value and appreciate the value of oversight and accountability. And as we move in the direction of on-budget support, that will become even more important. So I welcome the opportunity to speak to you today.
Thank you. General Basham.
Mr. Chairman, let me just say that we take these issues very seriously. As the Chairman's representative, we do not want to let the taxpayer money go to waste. So we very much appreciate working with the Special Investigator. We will continue to do that absolutely as we go forward for their request to be responsive. The mission, you know, to in Afghanistan is the primary issue, and to build the institutional capacity is really the core thing. As we leave, can they do it on their own? And that is the art of the commander's judgment out there. How do you, you know, as I use an analogy, how do you let them take the training wheels off to let them have a chance? And then that's from a logistics perspective. We've only been doing that for about a year or so. As we move forward, those challenges will only increase. So it is a journey. But with regard to the issues we've discussed today, we are focused and we will make sure that we make progress.
Thank you, General. Mr. Estes.
Likewise to what General Bash said, first, our folks out there are doing some very hard work, and we need to recognize that in trying to build this Afghan capacity. It is the key to our success in Afghanistan. We appreciate the dialogue with this committee on that matter today. We appreciate the work of the Special Inspector General. Because it is hard work, and not everything is gotten right the first time. We need help. We need help in helping them. So all help is appreciated in doing this. We are committed to doing that in a transparent way. I think that is important for our forces, and it is important to the American people to know how we are doing it. So we are going to continue pressing that forward, and again, appreciate the work.
Thank you, Mr. Sopko.
I would just like to conclude by saying that the importance of the records issue that we've spent so much time talking about is not so much whether the SIGAR got the records. The question is whether the records were used and have been used and will be used to hold the Afghan government and this program accountable so we don't have fraud, waste, and abuse. Thank you.
Thank you. Gentlemen, I appreciate your commitment, your work to this this country, the patriotism and the dedication you bring, but also those men and women, particularly, who are serving overseas or doing the hard, difficult work away from their families and doing what their country is asking them to do. So please, if nothing else, share that message with them. I appreciate you spending time before the committee. This is part of the process as our Constitution set up, and I do appreciate your participation here today. The committee stands adjourned.